as we bow before you, we have a number of special needs here tonight. We pray for these that we've mentioned who are ill, who are facing various diseases and treatments. Dear Father, I pray that you might just reach down and touch them with your grace. For these who are in the military and serving this nation, we pray that you would have your hand upon them and protect them. Most of all, that you would guide them by your word and your spirit. Dear Lord, we pray for the ministry of this congregation and your people all across this land. We pray that your Holy Spirit would stir up our hearts and minds to be more eager in ministering to those around us. Help us, Father, to have the fervency of spirit that the Lord Jesus demonstrated when he lived among us. We pray, Lord, that you would be with our educators and our students. We ask that you would protect them. We pray for our nation that its leaders might bow before you, listen to you, learn from you. Dear Father, we pray for the turmoil that has erupted in this country. I ask, O God, that your hand of grace would reach down from heaven and stop this senseless crisis. And we ask these things in your name. Amen. We're going to be looking at chapters 12, 13, and 14, which is Job's response after Zophar had spoken. But before we begin that, let's...
Pastor Jay?
Yes?
We're getting quite a bit of... Can we turn that down?
All right.
Turn my ear drums out. I thought it was fine.
How's that? That better?
Yes.
All right, good. Okay, before we get into Job's next discourse, which actually begins the second round, you might say, of discourses in this book of Job, let's remember Zophar's accusations from chapter 11. He was the third of Job's friends to speak, and he accused Job of being a guilty windbag, really. He said, "Is this talker to be vindicated? Will your idle talk reduce men to silence?" In other words, Job, you're just a big windbag. And he also accused him of being shamefully witless. That is, you're like an old mule. In verse 5, 6, he said, "Oh, how I wish that God would speak, that he would open his lips against you and disclose to you the secrets of wisdom." And he goes on and says, "But a witless man can no more become wise than a wild donkey's colt can be born a man." That's a pretty big put down. He says, not only are you a guilty windbag, but you're shameful and witless. And he also promised Job health and prosperity if Job would only devote his heart to God and put away the sin in his life. Verses 13 and 14. "Yet if you devote your heart to him and stretch out your hands to him, if you put away the sin that is in your hand and allow no evil to dwell in your tent, then you will lift up your face without shame, you will stand firm without fear, You will surely forget your trouble, recalling it only as waters gone by, or so that is, waters under the bridge. Life will be brighter than noonday, and darkness will become like morning. You will be secure because there is hope. You will look about you and take your rest in safety. You will lie down with no one to make you afraid, and many will court your favor. This was Zophar's promise. If only Job would just repent. Now, I want you to notice, I don't know if you picked up on this, but is this the number one? Of course, we know, because we've read the first two chapters, that that wasn't the problem with Job's illness and losses. That is, his sinfulness was not the problem. But I want to ask you, even if it was, is this the reason that a person should turn to the Lord and serve Him? Is that not the very reason Satan said that Job served God? He said, Job serves you, God, because you have built a hedge around him, you have made him prosperous, and you've given him good health, you've given him a nice family, you have made him famous, basically, right, in the community. And for, in fact, all around the area. And, well, is that why we should repent? Is so that we can have health and wealth? Is that why we ought to give and cast our bread on the water so that we can be financially secure and have good things? No. That's what the devil says. The reason people serve God. People like Job. Now, I want to tell you something. It's true about some folks. They do things to get things. They give in order to get. That's not why God should be served. God should be served because He is God. He is glorious. He is our Creator. We were created by Him and for Him. And that's why we ought to serve Him. And I'll tell you, you'll never be really satisfied, even in this life, unless you do that from a sincere heart. And Job will say in his next discourse, we'll read it in chapter 13 in a little while, that was not the reason he was serving God. Because Job said, though he, that is God, slay me, yet I will hope or trust in him. Even though he slays me. Even though I'm not wealthy and healthy again. Even though this situation I'm in leads in death, I'm not interested in that reason for serving God. There was more to it. And so here's what Job answered. And I want you to notice in these first six verses, it's a pretty sarcastic reply. Yeah. I guess Job could have one of those t-shirts or that, sarcasm, just one of my specialties. But then Job replied, doubtless, you are the people and wisdom will die with you. But I have a mind as well as you. I'm not inferior to you. Who does not know all these things? In other words, you're really not telling me anything that I haven't already been aware of. I have become a laughingstock to my friends. Though I called upon God and he answered, a mere laughingstock, though righteous and blameless. Men at ease have contempt for misfortune as the fate of those whose feet are slipping. The tents of marauders are undisturbed, and those who provoke God are secure. Those who carry their God in their hands. That is, I think he's talking about idolatry in particular. Those, in other words, people who have made their own gods. I'm thinking that's what Job meant by this. And notice this sarcasm. Surely wisdom will die with you. In other words, you guys think you're so smart that you have been so helpful and you've come up with all these right answers. Surely, when you're dead, all wisdom will be gone. Now, that's pretty sarcastic. You talk about speaking with your tongue in your cheek. That's about it. And he says, you don't have a monopoly on the truth. You don't have a monopoly on the truth. Your traditional theology has some holes in it. What he's trying to tell them. And he says, because look, there's men who are at ease, and there's marauders that are undisturbed. In other words, there's wicked people. There's people who aren't serving the Lord, who are, they're healthy and wealthy. Things are going well with their homes and families and their businesses. He says, basically, can't you see that? Don't you know that's true? And yet you hold to this idea that in this life, things are always, if you love God and serve Him, you're going to be healthy, wealthy, and wise. And if you don't, everything's going to go bad for you. And Job is saying, look, you ought to know that isn't how it is. If you just look around, you should see the evidence of it. Okay. And then notice in the next few verses, beginning in verse 7, but ask the animals, and they will teach you, or the birds of the air, and they will tell you, or speak to the earth, and it will teach you, or let the fish of the sea inform you. Which of all these does not know that the hand of the Lord has done this? In his hand is the life of every creature, and the breath of all mankind. Does not the ear test words, and as the tongue taste food? Is not wisdom found among the aged? Does not long life bring understanding? So Job suggests, hey, I think you need some re-education. You need to be re-educated. Just go to the animal world. Look at the things around you. Learn from the animal world that the righteous often suffer and the wicked succeed in this world. Not always, but it often happens that way. Notice that yet God is in control. Go to the animals, they know that. God is in control. Learn from the animal world that Job had tasted the counsel of his friends and found it lacking. I guess kind of like the white of an egg that's unsalted. Got Annie's. Annie's kind of salivating now, I guess. And so we see in these next few verses that Job was sincerely reverent. He says, beginning in verse 13, to God belong wisdom and power, counsel and understanding are his. What he tears down cannot be rebuilt. The man he imprisons cannot be released. If he holds back the waters, there is drought. If he lets them loose, they devastate the land. To him belong strength and victory. Both the deceived and the deceiver are his. He leads counselors away stripped and makes fools of judges. He takes off the shackles put on by kings and ties a loincloth around their waist. He leads priests away strict and overthrows men long established. He silences the lips of trusted advisors and takes away the discernment of elders. He pours contempt on nobles and disarms the mighty. He reveals the deep things of darkness and brings deep shadows into the light. He makes nations great and destroys them. He enlarges nations and disperses them. He deprives the leaders of the earth of their reason. He sends them wandering through a trackless waste. They grope in darkness with no light. He makes them stagger like drunkards. Here, we see that Job believes that God is great. He does all of these things. He believes in the sovereignty of God, that God's in charge of the world. And because God's wisdom, counsel, and understanding is great. He has a reverence, a respect for God's almighty power. He says that God makes nations great. He says that God deprives leaders of their reason. And even though this happened much later after Job, if we think about Daniel, you remember King Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar really went against the counsel of God and lifted himself up in pride. And what did God do? He gave him a dream. And part of that, well, that second dream that he had, Daniel really didn't want to have to tell him what it meant, because what it meant was he was going to go crazy, literally crazy. And he would eat grass like an ox. And he would do that for 7 years until he repented and turned himself around to God. And we read about it in Daniel. In fact, we read about it earlier in Daniel, but in Daniel chapter 5, verses 18 through 21, Belshazzar, Daniel's or Nebuchadnezzar's grandson, was king. And he is reminded of the history that he should have been aware of that happened to his grandfather when he just basically lost it and ran around like a wild animal until he came to his senses. And so Job says in this passage that he believes and knows that God is sovereign over individuals and over nations, irrespective of their rank, their wealth, or their social status. Paul essentially said the same thing when he preached on Mars Hill to the Greeks there in Athens in Acts chapter 17. Any further comments or questions on what Job has unleashed in chapter 12? All right, let's look to chapter 13 as he continues. He says, "My eyes have seen all this. My ears have heard and understood. What you know, I also know. I'm not inferior to you, but I desire to speak to the Almighty and to argue my case with God. You, however, smear me with lies. If only you would be altogether silent. For you, that would be wisdom. Hear now my argument. Listen to the plea of my lips. Will you speak wickedly on God's behalf? Will you speak deceitfully for Him? Will you show Him partiality? Will you argue the case for God? Would it turn out well if He examined you? Could you deceive Him as you might deceive men? He would surely rebuke you if you secretly showed partiality. Would not His neighbor terrify you? His splendor terrify you? Would not the dread of Him fall on you? Your maxims are proverbs of ashes. Your defenses are defenses of clay." Basically, Job is saying, "Fellas, you haven't told me anything I didn't already know. your worthless positions. He expresses his resentments in that he says, you misrepresent God. You misrepresent God. You say, God, you know, this is what God has shown us. This is what, you know, basically, this is what the generations before us have taught us and they've learned about God. But you're misrepresenting God. But he wants them to know, says, you know, it's serious to claim to speak on God's behalf. It's serious business. You remember in the New Testament, I believe it's in the book of James, we're told that, you know, not everybody ought to try to be a teacher. You better make sure that God's in it. Better make sure that the reason you want to be a teacher is because God wants you to be one. And you want to serve Him. In other words, don't just, because you're not looking for a position, don't just try to be an upfront person. Now, James didn't say that to discourage someone who feels the leadership of the Spirit to become a teacher. But he wants us to know that it's a serious thing to represent God. It's a serious matter. And so we need to carefully do so. And in fact, not only were they claiming to speak on God's behalf, but they were also attributing to Him actions that are contrary to what was true. What was that? What were they contributing to God that was contrary to what was really true? Nobody knows? Want to make a guess? They were saying, Job, the reason these things have happened to you is because you have sinned. That wasn't the reason. They pretended to know what the problem was and pretended to speak in God's behalf. And what they said was not true. And yet, they acted as if it was coming straight from God. You might say, this is how it is.
The uniqueness of this whole thing is there's only two people that did it.
Yeah.
Job and God.
And Satan. As far as the conversations going.
Right. Yeah.
Well, and Job didn't know.
He didn't know why the problem was going on.
He thought he did something wrong.
He was beginning to wonder.
Yeah.
Yeah. In other words, they're stirring him up some. Yeah. You know. He's beginning to wander now, and we're going to see a little of that in some of his comments. And yet, he's telling them, says, guys, you've made an inaccurate diagnosis, and you claim to be counselors, and you might say you're like a physician, that you aren't licensed. You're an unlicensed physician. You're not trained to do this. You're not really doing what you're saying that you're doing. Said you view yourselves as God's appointing physician or God's prosecuting attorney. Could you withstand God's examination of your motives and claims? That's what he's asking. If you had to stand before God, could you stand up before Him? What did Jesus tell us about when we saw an issue in someone's life, how are we to approach that? You remember?
Say that again.
Gently. Correct.
Okay. All right. If Jesus instructed us before we try to correct somebody else to make certain of something. Brother Bob, what was it?
Take the plank out of your own eye before you check it better.
Right. Make sure there's not a plank in your own eye before you try to extract something out of someone else's life. Now, I want you to not go further than Jesus meant with that.
Right.
He didn't say, don't try to extract a problem. What he said is make sure that you've got a clear view in your own life that things are okay with you before you start trying to deal with somebody else. Paul said, in different words, said something similar. He said that we're to try to restore a fallen brother or sister who has fallen into sin, but to be careful lest we also be tempted. Maybe tempted with pride, for example, or tempted to look down upon them, or tempted to stomp them down rather than to restore them. See? And so Job says, look, if you stood before God, and another thing Jesus said, with what measure you meet, it will be measured again to you. In other words, if this is your little cup here that you're measuring out, that's the same kind of cup God's going to use on you. See? So you better be careful that you use the right standard. Any other comments? He goes on to say, in verse 12, essentially, your counsel is no better than the ashes of the city dump. They're not worth anything. And then beginning in verse 13, he says, keep silent and let me speak. Then let come to me what may. Why do I put myself in jeopardy and take my life in my hands? Though he slay me, yet will I hope in him. I will surely defend my ways to his face. Indeed, this will turn out for my deliverance. For no godless man would dare come before him. Listen carefully to my words. Let your ears take in what I say. Now that I have prepared my case, I know I will be vindicated. Can anyone bring charges against me? If so, I will be silent and die. Here we see Job is again declaring his integrity. And now again, he has never said that he was without sin. I mean, he was a person who offered sacrifices for sins. And if he believed he was sinless, he wouldn't offer sacrifices for sins.
Don't you think that's why in the very first verse or so, all that was laid out?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to prove his case before us before we even get started.
Right. Yeah. Right now, off the top of my head, I can't remember where in 1 John it is, but in 1 John, if you aren't careful about how you read that, in part of it. Now, the very first part, it tells us if, in fact, in the very first chapter, we're told that if we say that we're without sin, and he's writing to believers, this letter was written in 1 John to believers. If we say that we're without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Okay. But he goes on to write that essentially, if you're a follower of Christ, you live above sin. So what does he mean? How do we mesh these together? Some people have said, well, you know, you come to a place and you you received this, the Holy Spirit in a special way, and you have a second work of grace in your life, and you're from that there on, you're without sin. You never sin. I tell you, I've known some folks that claim that, but that wasn't what I saw in their experience. Because what John is trying to tell us is that the general tenor of our life is one that is growing in the grace and knowledge of Jesus. We're being sanctified progressively, set apart, growing in His character through the power of His Word living in our hearts and the power of God's Spirit making it real in us and producing the fruit of the Spirit, as it mentioned in Galatians 5. Brother Bob.
Well, like you said, if we didn't sin anymore, why did John write John 1 John 1:9?
If we confess our sins, yes, He's faithful and just, yes, to forgive us our sins, yes. Right. And so the reality is, Job was not Jesus. He was not a sinless person. But he was one of those, like John is talking about, of believers in the New Testament whose life has been transformed and is being renewed by the power of God each day. They're growing more and more in character like Jesus. And that's the character that Job was demonstrating, a character of integrity and, as God says, blameless. Think about what Paul wrote to Timothy. And he said, when it comes to pastors and to deacons, one of their requirements is that they be blameless. Does that mean they're to be sinless? That's the goal, isn't it? But I think one of the things that, and let me just make this comment while we're on that issue. Anything, any goal, any character goal that God expects out of church leaders, whether they're pastors, deacons, trustees, Sunday school teachers, worship leaders, whatever. Whatever He expects of their character, that is what He wants out of all of us.
Amen.
You see, that's what He wants from all of us. And so don't fail to accept a role that God may be moving in your heart to accept. A place of service, because, oh, well, that standard is a goal. I don't think I can meet that standard. Listen, if it's the standard of God, we need to ask God to help us meet that standard.
Okay? We can't meet it. We can't meet it on our own.
No, we absolutely cannot.
You know, now I think Job is about to realize that here when he goes into his prayer.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
And then he gets a bit despondent.
Yes. Yes. Uh-oh. I guess we're not going to finish. But let me finish these verses that we shared from 13 to 19. As Job declares in his integrity, he tells us that basically, I know that to approach God, you want to approach Him basically humbly and reverently. Because to approach God was actually an act of faith. You know why? Because Job knew, and even his three friends were aware of what Moses knew, that to approach God in a disrespectful manner without a desire to be holy like him is basically to put your life in danger. To put your life in danger. And Job was so certain of his innocence that he believed God would vindicate him. That's how confident he was. He says, I want, basically, God, I'd like to come into your courtroom and present my case. I'd like to hear from you. I've listened to all these guys, and they're not telling me anything about the issue. They're off base. They're off target. They're no more worthwhile than a heap of ashes. But I think I would like to speak to you. I'd like to confront you. And listen, if Job wasn't pretty confident that his heart was right with God, he wouldn't have asked for that meeting. Because what did he say? Why do I put myself in jeopardy and take my life in my hands?
He knows what's at stake.
Yeah. Exactly. He says, look, I'm confident that I will be vindicated and delivered. And so he's upholding his integrity. Okay. All right. Well, we'll have to take this up next time. Okay? Do we have any other questions or comments that we want to make before we dismiss? We'll try to start at 13, verse 20, next week.
You know, you wonder what, it doesn't change the story, but what tone of voice was being used? These guys were talking back and forth.
Yeah.
Was it finger pointing? Was it being very rational, courtroom kind of thing? Or was it like veins popping out in there?
I think when the first and oldest of the three friends began, he began very tenderly, you know, in other words, he began softly.
Opening statements.
But yeah, but as the conversation progresses, things are getting a little bit more vigorous. In fact, Bildad, he just started right off the bat. He's pretty aggressive anyhow, you know. And now you see Zophar, he is not exactly mild. You know, he's pretty much pointing his finger. You're a sinner. I know your problem. And if you'll do this, this is what God will do for you. Okay.
But 13 verse 5. If only you would all be altogether silent, you, that would be wisdom.
Yes, exactly. Well, that's a pretty plain way to put it, yes. Remember, Job begins with prose, the style of prose in writing, and it ends with prose. But in the middle, it's poetry. It's Hebrew poetry. And so that may be one of the reasons we kind of find the discussion a little bit challenging. Because it is Hebrew poetry. And but yes, I would say that's a pretty accurate point. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Verse 40.
Why don't you just be quiet?
Verse 40 calls them quacks, or positions.
Yeah. All right, let's close in prayer. Father, again, we bow before you. We thank you for your word. Help us, Lord, to understand it and rightly divide it. Help us to make the applications to our lives and the lives of others we know and love that are accurate and appropriate. Help us to rely upon you for wisdom, and we pray for your wisdom. We know that wisdom comes from you. We ask for your help that we might understand not only the things about our own individual lives, but about those around us, so that we might minister to them in your behalf. Father, we pray that you would guard the lives of those who are facing this hurricane. We pray that you would just minister to them, give them a sense of reality and urgency, and protect them in this dangerous situation. Father, we ask these things in your name, and we thank you for your blessing on our lives. Amen.